Hi everyone! In this video, I will explain in detail all the features of a modern template for NPM package. We are using TypeScript, ESM modules, and a series of tools to improve software quality and team collaboration. We go from creating the repository to publishing the package into a private NPM registry and creating a GitHub release. There are dozens of templates for that, and my goal here is not to sell this as one of the best, but help you to have a better grip on all things we are doing here. I'm sure you already know some of what I am about to tell you, but I challenge you to stay until the end and say you haven't learned anything new. So let's get started. The first step is to open the template repository. Click Use this template and then create a new repository. Fill name, description, and choose the visibility. Then confirm create a repository from this template. You can now clone the repository in your local computer and open it in your editor. Let's open the README file and follow the installation steps. This template uses only dev dependencies. Now we need to create a .env file so we can declare the environment variable GitHub token. This variable is used by the package semantic release to access our GitHub repository. To create a personal access token in GitHub, click your profile photo and then settings. In the left sidebar, roll all the way down and click developer settings. In the new left sidebar, click personal access tokens and tokens classic option. Then click Generate New Token. And don't forget to copy the token before closing the page. Now, just copy the token here. As env files usually contain sensitive data, like secrets, they must never be pushed to your remote repository. Because of that, the template has an entry in the .ignore file for this type of file. The template uses a ISC license by default. You just need to fill the year and the collaborators. If you want to use a different license or want to know more options, you can visit the License MD site. They have tons of licenses, including the full text, permissions, limitations, and conditions. I will put the link down below in the description. You can also add other files as security policy and a contributing MD if you want to open your package for collaboration. This file can be interesting even for a private company, in case the package is maintained by different teams. Let's look at the dev dependencies in the package.json file. Semantic release is the NPM package we are using to automate versioning, publishing, and releasing. Changelog is a plugin to create or update a changelog file in our project based on the commit messages. Git is a plugin to commit release files to our project's repository. I'm using types for Node because most of the time I'm a backend developer. This template uses Node 18 as reference, so we have types 18 installed. For a different version, you should use the correspondent version of types, but consider only the major release of the node you have installed to choose types version, since types doesn't follow each minor version of node. Let's skip the vitesse coverage for now. .env CLI reads the .env file and pass the environment variables to an application. In our case, it's being used to pass the GitHub token to the semantic release package. We are using ESLint for TypeScript. A linter is a program that performs a static analysis on our code to find potential structure errors based on a set of best practice rules. Husky is a tool to create and manage Git hooks. A Git hook is some action we want to do before or after some Git stage. For example, in our case, we are gonna run a linter before each commit. If the linter finds any issue, it blocks the commit. Lint-staged is invoked by Husky to work on staged files. The staged files are those you git added and they are ready to be committed. This is interesting because, for instance, we can run lint only on these files, what is less time consuming in each commit. Prettier is a very new tool to format our source code using some best practice rules. This can be very helpful to keep a common code style in a collaborative environment. TSApp is a bundler powered by ESBuild, which means it's very fast. Let's open the TSApp config file first. TSApp creates an output folder named dist by default. In the entry property, we want to publish all files in the source folder except those related to test. Here, I like to use the mock specification in files with mock data. So, you can review that based on your needs. Clean set to true will clean the output folder for each building. Platform can be Node or browser. Note that we are using ESM modules. Target is the flavor of JavaScript that your code will compile to. ESNext means TSApp is assuming all of the latest JavaScript features. Again, you may need to adjust that. DTS is set to true, so the data types declaration file will be generated. Tree shaking is already set to true by default, but I've declared here to explain that when true, it eliminates dead code in our package during the build. For example, an unreachable code. Source map is true, so we have the information to translate back to the JavaScript generated files to TypeScript. This is very good for debugging. And bundle is set to false because we won't really bundle our npm package. Now let's look into the tsconfig file. Strict is to use a wider range of type checkings. Mode resolution determines how TypeScript will find code that you import. NodeNext mode integrates with Node's native ESM support. Allow synthetic default imports, set to true, provides backwards compatibility and it is only for type checking. It allows to import packages with default import when the package has not explicitly specified a default export. Force consistent casing in file names is to ensure we use the exactly name casing used by a file in our ESM imports. No implicit any is set to true, so we need to use type annotations to avoid TypeScript to fall back to a type of any when it cannot infer the type. Vtest is a fast test runner powered by Vt. So, this is interesting if you want to work with packages for web apps. It supports TypeScript and JSX out of the box. To check our test coverage, I'm using C8. It does a code coverage using Node's V8 built-in functionality. Code coverage is a metric to check how much of our source code is being tested. Let's look at the Vtest configuration file. We are using the defaults, just adding settings for coverage. As I've said, we are using C8 as the provider. Reporter indicates that we want to generate the results in text. It appears in our terminal at the end of testing and in HTML formats. The HTML is created in a folder named coverage, generated after each testing with the option coverage. The source property is to inform which files should be considered for coverage calculation. In our case, all files from the source folder. And then we have our percentage thresholds. For example, here it's expected that the tests execute at least 80% of the lines in our code. Just to understand branches, when we have a conditional as an if, we have different branches of execution that should be tested. Let's roll up a bit and look at the scripts. TSApp has a watch mode, so every time we change a file, it will rebuild the package. We use the vtest option run when we want to run the tests just once. And the watch mode is the default mode for vtest. The option coverage checks the thresholds we have defined. I don't have a script for prettier because I'm using a plugin for my editor that triggers it every time I save a file. Almost all IDEs have a plugin for that. Besides, I have a pre-commit hook, which means before each commit. It runs prettier on the files to be committed. The prettier rules are in its runtime configuration file. Just a remark, you probably already know, but the suffix rc in configuration files as lint and prettier means runtime configuration. For ESLint, I have only a script in case we want to lint and fix all issues. Particularly, I recommend to do that real time when you are writing the code. This way, you have more control of what you are doing, and at the same time, it's an opportunity to learn the reason behind the issue. The max warnings option set to 0 will prevent commit if there are any warnings. The report and use it disable directives option reports directive comments like ESLint disable next line when no errors would have been reported on that line anyway. Note the prepare script. This script is created by Husky automatic mode installation. It is called automatically by the npm lifecycle before the package is packed. For example, each time we run npm install. We shouldn't call it directly. It creates a shell script used by Husky to be used with the git hooks. Let's look the .husky folder. We have declared two hooks, one before each commit and another before each push. In pre-commit, we are running the tests and calling lint staged. In our case, the lint staged runtime configuration. Here, we are working only on the staged files that matches these extensions. If the tests, prettier or lint, fail, the commit is aborted. The pre-push checks the coverage. Before we push our changes and create a pull request, it can be interesting to check if the tests we added are sufficient to reach the expected thresholds. Let's go back to the package.json file. We need to change the name, field description, keywords, and author's data. The file's property describes the entries to be included when we are publishing our package to our npm registry. The package.json, readme, and license files are always included. The publish config is used by npm publish. In our case, I'm using Verdatio running locally as a npm proxy registry. The repository URL is important because semantic release will read this property to know the repository to be used. Homepage and bugs are additional info. The property engines is to ensure the correct versions of npm and node to be used with this template. Let's open the git attributes file. These options allow a common behavior related to the end of lines in files for different operating systems. For instance, Windows uses carry as return and line feed. Mac and Linux use only line feed. Now, let's look at the source folder. The main index file is just to export everything we want from our package. The inner index do the same, just with a more restricted scope. The template has a small code example, the user type, and the function say hello from template. So we can test it out of the box. I'm not forcing a global folder for testing, because I believe this is much more related to the way you or your team works. The important thing here is to have good automated test cases and running them each time you change your code. In my case, I prefer keep related things next one to another. So when we have any change, it's easier to identify the impact on the existing files. Note that VTest shares syntax with Jest. The difference here is that the functions used like describe, test, and expect must be imported from VTest. Now, let's run the tests and build our package. Let's commit our changes and push them to the remote repository. Just for testing, I will use the template's original code. Note my commit message. I used the type feed to indicate that this commit is a new feature, and then I put a description. This follows the approach named conventional commits. The conventional commit format consists of three parts: a type, an optional scope, and a description. Semantic release will decide the package version based on this commit message. Note that our Git hooks are working: testing, formatting, and linting. The same for pre-push. Now we can release our package. Note that even though our commit is a feature without breaking change, semantic release has used a major change, 1.0.0. This is because it's the first version. From here, it should follow the commit's logic. And see, the package has been published as well. You should have realized by now that semantic release automatically creates a changelog file. Let's look at the release runtime configuration. Note that the continuous integration option is false. This is because in this video we have released and published our package locally, and this has its limitations. So, in another video, I'm going to show you how to use GitHub Actions to do all this. We can explore more about conventional commits and semantic versioning as well. Let me know what you think about these topics. Leave in your comments. That's it for today. We have covered a lot about our package template, and I hope it has been a good run. Please, if you find value in this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. It makes a huge difference. Thanks for watching, and I see you in our next video.